In our Old Testament lesson this morning, we heard about Moses receiving the words of the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments are a kind of experiment in human civilization. What would happen if people lived by these rules? Do not murder, do not covet, do not steal, and on At their heart, these laws are a foundation for a good and just society. They are not a punch list of how to make God happy, nor are they just a list of arbitrary do's and don'ts. They are a guide for living together well. The consequence of violating the Ten Commandments is not that God is offended. Rather, the consequence of breaking the Ten Commandments is having to live in a world in which the Ten Commandments are broken. The consequence of lying is that eventually someone will lie to you. The consequence of coveting is that eventually someone will be jealous of you. The consequence of not observing a period of Sabbath rest is that eventually someone else, while not resting, will drag you into their own ceaseless work. The Ten Commandments are no brilliantly wise innovation. They are foolishly simple principles for building a just and equitable society. Of course, as we all know, the experiment of the commandments has not gone all that well. Sure, we've made some progress, but still fail to achieve the kind of society that the commandments envision. The reasons for this are many, though chief among them is that most of us, in some way or another, think that we are too clever, too smart, too wise to be bound just by the words of the commandments. We say, sure, the instructions of God are good in principle, but life is complicated, too complicated, to be hemmed in like that. We love to make exceptions to the commandments by redefining what they mean, and more importantly, what they could possibly never mean. I'd like to consider together a few examples this morning. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Most of us who grew up in church were taught from a very young age that this meant one thing: saying the name of God together with a curse word. You all know what I mean. Most of us probably avoid it, except when it's particularly satisfying to say it. You've stubbed your toe or someone cut you off in traffic. It just takes the edge off like nothing else, right? But this takes the name of the Lord in anger, much more than in vain. When we cleverly reduce the commandment to mean just this one thing, saying God's name with a curse, we make it almost trivial. All the while, there's no end to the vain ways people use their words to attribute to God things that have nothing to do with God. How many holy men and holy women have stood with the support of their religious communities and blamed natural disasters on God, or illness on God, or hunger on God, attributing to God what is not from God is completely vain. How many religious people have discriminated, hated, and punished others in the name of God, imagining that God disapproves of all the same people that they do? Think for a moment of all the ways God's name is used in the sake of vanity, for political agendas, to justify violence, to silence those with whom we disagree. Do not use the name of the Lord your God in vain, God says. But we think we're wise enough to know when he meant it and when he did not. You shall not kill. This is different than taking the Lord's name in vain as we have received it. Sure, we've uttered the words we're not supposed to, but most of us have probably not taken a life. Wanting to kill would be wrong. And all the while, killing goes on every single day in the world. And we are so clever and wise to imagine that we have no part in it. If we ourselves do not pull the trigger, if we ourselves do not fire the missile, if we ourselves do not take away the food or the medicine, then we imagine that we are not complicit in the fault at all. We think it's not our responsibility when the policies and agendas that benefit us result in the deaths of others. You shall not kill, God says. Yet we think we are wise enough to know when he meant it and when he did not. Do not make for yourself an idol out of anything. We would never do that. We would never bow down before a god of wood or stone. And we are wise enough to know that this could not possibly have anything to do with the flags to which we pledge allegiance or sing songs to or look to for inspiration. Nothing to do with the sports teams which command our time and energy and emotions. Never mind that our religion reserves all of these acts for God. Worshipping idols could have nothing to do with the television which we watch for 5 hours a day on average, or the smartphones or devices which the average American uses for 2 hours and 51 minutes every day. Or any of the things to which we devote our unending time and undivided attention. Do not make for yourself an idol out of anything, God says. And we are wise and clever enough to know when he meant it and when he did not. When Moses came down from the mountain of God, he brought with him a blueprint of what society could be. And we worked tirelessly editing it, making God more palatable, more reasonable, working to create the kind of world that we would prefer for ourselves and those like us. How much more do we rationalize and contextualize the words of Jesus, which make the Ten Commandments seem rather tame? The commandments offer a vision of how to live together on earth. But Jesus taught those who would dare to follow him how to live not just on earth, but as citizens of heaven, here as visitors for a time. Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest, Jesus says. If anyone strikes you on the cheek, turn the other also. If anyone wants to take your coat, give your shirt as well, Jesus says. You have heard it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemy. Pray for those who persecute. This is how we must practice living here and now if we are to flourish in the larger life of God. We redefine the foolishly simple commandments to let ourselves off the hook. Pretend it's not us who need to change, but the others, the ones who deceive, the ones who steal. Those people who blatantly and flagrantly break those laws. It is weak, We feel weak to admit our guilt, to admit that we have hurt one another. It feels foolish. We feel foolish to turn the cheek and drop our weapons when our enemies hold on to theirs. And yet, as we heard a few moments ago, as the Apostle Paul reminds us, the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. But to all those who are being saved, it is the power of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. If we want to really claim God's vision of how our world can be, it will not arrive with the best and cleverest of our efforts to make it happen. We have tried far too many times in the course of human history. The way of the cross is our only hope. The way of loving enemies, of welcoming strangers, of humble honesty with ourselves and others, the way of radical generosity. This is a stumbling block to many and foolishness to others. It is the way of abundant life for those of us who know that God's weakness is our strength. Amen.